Good evening and welcome to another edition of Filmnut. I am your host, Jeff Schubert. Glad you can join us. Set to open in U.S. theaters at 12.01 a.m. tonight, or maybe it's tomorrow morning, depending on how you look at it, is the sequel to the critical and box office hit Iron Man. Of course, I am talking about Iron Man 2, which has already grossed over $100 million internationally in foreign domestic receipts. That's great. Looking forward to it. My guest tonight, Joseph Cicio, is a second unit camera operator on the film. In addition to Iron Man 1 and 2, his credits include Spider-Man 2 and 3, Die Hard, Live Free or Die Hard, G.I. Joe, Rise of the Cobra, Charlie's Angels, Full Throttle, and Deep Impact, just to list a few. Here he is, Joseph Cicio. Joseph, thanks for joining us.
Great to be here, Jeff. Thanks for inviting me.
Oh, it's great to have you. I mean, it must be very exciting. Now, of course, if I had an actor, maybe director or writer on, one of the first things I'd say is, are you so excited to have, you know, such a, you know, big blockbuster, sure to be a huge hit coming out tomorrow? They're saying it's going to challenge The Dark Knight for biggest weekend or something. As a camera operator, do you get that same level of excitement as the actors do, as the directors and so forth?
Sure. I mean, they have maybe a little bit more financial incentive for because of residuals and whatnot, but no, you still want it to do well, and you know, that's a lot of, you know, people's work there on the screen, and yeah, it's all good if it does well at the box office. It means that it has some great hang time and hopefully the, you know, good entertainment. So yeah,
sounds good. So in the introduction, I made the distinction. You are a second unit camera operator for the film.
I was one of the second. I was the A operator for second unit on the film, and I operate first units as well. But the second unit on Iron Man, you know, both one and two is a lot of fun. Challenging, but it's great to deal with the.
So now, as the second unit, what separates the second unit from the first unit? What is the first unit shooting, and what is the second unit shooting?
Primarily, first unit is shooting most of the dialogue with the actors, also some action and some effects. In the case of an Iron Man, nearly every frame has got something that's going to have a visual effect or possibly some action. So the second unit's mission primarily is to do the bigger action sequences and the bigger visual effect sequences. So that's usually the delineation is the second unit is more
of
the action
unit. Was it on one of the Spider-Man movies that more than 50% of the movie?
I think on Spider-Man 2, it was the second unit did nearly 52% of the running time of the movie, but it was an enormous project. There was at any given time there was, you know, 3 to 4 units going on, so it was like a 24/7 operation. But sometimes on that particular project, it was a lot of work that had to be done by the second unit.
Now, I think I counted right, but on IMDb, Internet Movie Database, it had 9 camera operators listed. It had 4 second unit camera operators listed, and it had 2 additional camera operators listed. What does everyone, A, is that right? And B, what is everyone doing? I know you broke down in terms of unit, but if you can get it even a little more specific.
Yeah, on the second unit, there's, depending on some of the sequences, there's one that, you know, it's called like the Monaco sequence, and a lot of cameras that have to be operated. And so on certain days, we'd have at least, I think, 9 operators. And
let's talk about that. The Monaco sequence, if you guys have seen the trailer for the movie yet or not, this is where we see Robert Downey Jr. driving on the racetrack. We got Mickey Rourke's character kind of shows up and is breaking his car in half, and there's driving, there's cars crashing, and there's a lot of effects going on. That's what you're referring to right now, right?
Exactly.
So let's talk about what went into shooting that scene. How many cameras, how many operators, and so forth?
There was a lot of different formats going on depending on the, you know, what we had to do, but primarily Jonathan Taylor, who's the director and the director of photography for the second unit, he wanted to shoot as much vista vision as possible, which is 35 millimeter turned on its side. It's 8 perforations wide. It gives visual effects people a lot of room to pan, tilt on negative, to blow up 20%, 30%, 40% on negative, so it gives them a lot of ability. So we did a lot of vista vision work, but they're limited by frame rates. Some of the stuff that we had to do had to be high speed. Most Vista Vision cameras can only do, or the ones that are small enough for us to work with, can only do about 72 frames. And so we are.
You're talking about frames per second?
Frames per second.
So traditionally, most filmmakers are familiar with the 24 frames per second, but you wanted to shoot it in at a faster frame rate.
Exactly. And just because of the event, those cars being, you know, torn apart, ripped apart, you want to get as many frames as possible. We had a photosonics camera that was filming from overhead, and that's running at 300 frames, or I think it was right at about 300 frames. A phantom camera that was on a sled that was in parallel with the movement of the Formula One cars. We had a phantom, an Aeroflex 435. The 435 was doing 150 frames. A VistaVision, what's called a bokeh, it was doing about 72 frames. And then the Phantom, which is a digital high-speed camera, was doing about 300 frames, maybe a little better than 300 frames. So just trying to cover it with a lot of cameras, and some of the 4-perf Super 35 cameras that were operated deep, long lens, they were shot at 24 frames. So you just have a lot of balance with where you can go with high speed, slow motion shots, and then also with not showing too much to the audience, where 24 frames really allows you to get back to that real quick movement when things are moving at 100 feet a second or faster in the case with the Monaco sequence.
So. Now, one camera that you were particularly excited about doesn't cost very much for a big budget movie. The Canon 5D was involved in this scene. And what did it do, and what about that camera excites you?
It's a great digital platform. I mean, it's you know, the fact that it is inexpensive, and it gives gives people a lot of opportunity to shoot.
It's about a $2,500-$3,000 camera.
$2,500-$2,600. It's probably, now that it's been out for a year, it's probably cheaper now. But
used on Iron Man.
Used on Iron Man. I found one of the guys at Canon. His name is Jung Jin An, who's an incredible, incredible guy. They're really knowledgeable of the technology. I had met Jung and asked him if maybe I could shoot a test with it, and I took it out and just we shot some tests around LA. Just at that time, it didn't have manual control over its high definition function, which was tragic, but it was a bit of an afterthought by Canon. They just wanted to simply have a HD function, so an AP photographer could flip a switch and also get pretty useful high definition footage and load it up on the satellite, and the news organizations could use it. They made it idiot proof pretty much, but totally impossible to use for what we needed, which was to really have a locked exposure. And Jung came out, and we played around and tried to get some decent exposures, and took it to eFilm, where that's a wonderful company that does the digital intermediate for a lot of films, and Iron Man, Spider-Man. They just do reference level work. Josh Haney was one of the guys over there that went to, and Maddie Libatique, the main unit cameraman, director of photography, Jonathan Taylor, the second unit director of photography, myself, we went and looked at the test and said, you know, the film out test didn't look bad. And so, you know, there was the idea that we could put them onto the Formula One cars, knowing that they'd the cars are going to be destroyed doing 70 miles an hour. We could protect these cameras as best we could. We used a $30 Pelican case, painted the same color as the F1 cars, and basically, we did some damage to some of the cameras, but everything was repairable.
I want to get to the instant messages for tonight, get started with that. Let's see what we have here on the board. Sean O would like to ask, what are some of the biggest changes you've seen over the years, and have they affected your career as a camera operator? How long have you been doing this?
I've been operating for about 12 years. Before that, I was a focus puller, a first assistant cameraman, and so been doing it for about 20, a little over 20 years total, but operating for about 12 years.
Right. Do you see a lot of changes, especially if you look at the first 10 years you were involved in the business versus the last 10 years? Was there a lot more consistency in that first 10 because we know in the last 10 there's certainly been a lot of changes, right?
Yeah, there's a lot of changes going on. I mean, the technology, film is still such a robust, mature system, and it's around for a reason because it's very predictable and the imagery is great. The digital cameras that are coming are fantastic, but it's a tricky place to be because, like in the case of RED, the first generation RED cameras get replaced by the second generation RED cameras, which get replaced by maybe a 5D or who knows what's coming down the pipe. And so that's changing a lot of how production does what it does. But it's just, it's exciting, you know. There's always going to be problems with budgets, not able to support a certain amount of crew people, and you're doing way too many hours on
set. Do you feel like you're constantly having to relearn your craft, if you will?
Not so much relearn anything, but it definitely learn how to deal with some of the new technologies that are out there. In the case with the 5D, it's really trying to take that format and mold it into something that is a familiar technique. In the case, we've been doing a lot of things with film cameras, and even like the Genesis and the D21 Arri, the Genesis, which is a Panavision full-frame Super 35 camera. Those cameras are wonderful, but everything is in a state of evolution at this point. You know, whatever is going to replace film may just not exist yet, or maybe it exists next week. I don't know, but right now, that technology is not really changing so much the technique. We just have to learn how to deal with the element in the field. And
right, the craft is the same, but how to get it to do what you want it to do and expect it to do, and then see how it looks once you've done those things.
Exactly.
Right? To make sure what's in here is what you're seeing. Right?
Exactly. 3D now is, from Avatar, proved to the theater owners that this is a viable place to go. Taking $400 million in 4 years to produce something maybe is not a viable way to do. I don't think the studios are going to run out and want to do a bunch of avatars in that business model. But the 3D gear is evolving really quickly. But to go out and shoot a 3D project now means a whole different reboot on. Yeah, we can take some bits of gear, like an ultimate arm or like a Russian arm type setting, or a helicopter nose mount, try to put 3D gear on it. It's difficult because the gear is stepping back as far as size and weight. It's like stepping back 30 years, and you're talking about 100-pound camera systems. And the Aeroflex 235, like a panavised version of that, it's a really small camera, and it's the culmination of so many years of maturity in that film world. And so to go and deal with cameras that are now have to go into this much larger size, physical size, that's a difficult thing to have to deal with.
I was going to ask you another question, but out of the corner of my eye, seeing IM, that is perfectly appropriate to what we're already talking about. So I will get to that first. Broken sausage. What happened? How'd you break? He wants to ask you, have we had the chance, I'm guessing he means you, to work with equipment for any 3D movies?
I've looked around at some things. The Paradise Effects, they've got a great system. There's some friends are doing some testing for a show right now that dropped by to take a look at, but I haven't had a chance to use. There's not been any 3D necessity for 3D until Avatar kind of started to, 3D has been around for a long time, and it's just been a tough format to get audience, to sit there and wear the polarizers or the red and blue, the primary color glasses. It was never a great effect. I think the technology has gotten better. 3D in the future, I would hope, won't require a 100-pound camera system. Right. Everything I've looked at so far makes there's a project that I may be doing this summer. It's a car commercial, and we'll do it in 3D. It makes sense if you have a 3D theater, and the audience is sitting down and they've paid their money to watch what a wonderful place to show show a car doing what it's doing in 3D. But it means that we can't quite shoot it the way we would do it if we were shooting in 35 or a combination of. I was DPing a Toyota commercial right before all the recall stuff happened, but we're shooting 3 perf Super 35 with a 16:9 extraction for HD TV, but also used a lot of the Canon gear, just suction cups right on the cars, and we could digitally take them out, but just a real quick way to get an angle, get a shot that required nothing, and of course you're not even shooting film, it's free, essentially, just taking the time to do it, and it blends really well with film. The problem with relying on 3D rigs, I can't suction cup 100-pound anything to a car, and then you have issues with convergence, and so you need a stereographer to get out, and it's once it's all set up and working well, it's stunning, but it's just a slower process, and that is what's at the core of the whole problem. Avatar took 4 years to do it. They probably needed more than 4 years, and they were, releasing the print still wet, so it's just a time-consuming process. So.
I want to get back to the Monaco scene for a second, like I mentioned. Sure. You alluded to all the different cameras and film cameras, the Canon 5D, the digital attached to the car. We had someone who specializes in color correction and post-production on a few weeks ago, maybe a little longer than that. But he was talking about the challenges of using two different cameras and color matching in post-production. Sounds like you used a lot more than two. So talk about, and you were shooting at all different speeds. So talk about that process and what goes into bringing that all together and looking aesthetically right.
With film cameras, whether you're shooting an ARRI, panavised ARRI, and a panavised ARRI is basically an Airflex body that has a Panavision mount, so you have commonality on all your lenses, so you can use Panavision lenses throughout, and that's the case with Iron Man 2. So all your film cameras, say on that scene, we're shooting day exterior, and we shot 250 ASA Kodak daylight film. So it doesn't matter whether you have a Photosonics, an Panavised ARRI, any other film camera, as long as you have commonality on your negative, all that's going to go into the workflow with a very similar color correction. And so, but when you start using a 5D or like a Phantom camera and going into the digital realm, the closest you can get is just rating those platforms at the same, if not the same ASA, at least rating them in daylight. So instead of, we just simply put the color temperature at 5600 with the Canons, same with the Phantom. We were running, at that time, you could only do 30 frames per second with the Canons, which we needed if it could have gone 60, we would have used it at 60, but 30 frames worked well. And we rated the chip at 100 ASA. We had plenty of daylight. I think that at a 50th of a second, or a 60th of a second, actually, we kept the shutters right at shutter speed right at a 60th. So it came out at a right dead center of the lens. I think a 5.68 split or something like that, and that was perfect. We got as close as what we could do to get to our film base ASA and color temperature, or when you're shooting daylight, and that's about it. As soon as it goes to e-film into the digital intermediate, as those digital files come up, they see where you are. We also shoot grayscales, so the light for that particular moment when we were getting ready to shoot is common, whether it's film or digital. So the telecine, the colorist has a real good basis, so he can get it dialed in pretty quickly.
So then again, part of the expertise of you or whoever ultimately makes that decision is knowing each camera and knowing how to set it in accordance to get the most approximate look to match film.
Exactly. I mean, it's like if we had been shooting any other digital platform, we would address it the same way, whether it was Red or an Arri D21 or a Genesis or Sony F35. It all, you want it to be as filmic as possible, and you want to treat it as such.
And so, how easy or difficult is it to bounce around from one digital platform or one digital system to another and find those settings?
Easy. They're menu driven as far as, and there's usually with, we didn't have a DIT with us on the second unit, so we were just, because it was very experimental. Canon gave us four camera bodies to use. For the ones that knew that it was, that, and they gave us manual control of the camera, but we had to sign non-disclosure agreements, and so we couldn't talk much about what was going on there. But now the, you know, that it really changed how that, how Canon addresses the D5 now that camera does 24p, 30p, and there's manual control, which unleashed the power of what that.
It's like a birthday present for you.
It was unheard of. You know, even the guy at Canon said this is not going to happen, but. Somehow, the guys in Japan wrote the firmware, and we were out experimenting with it within a matter of weeks.
Now, before I get to my next IM, what is a DIT?
He's a digital information technician.
There you go.
I think DIT is a digital information technician.
Mr. Paisley, what project were you most excited to be a part of, and why?
Boy, there's all of them have. All of them have their moments, and certainly Iron Man 2 was one of them. I have to say, each project is so different, and even though you're using the same gear and the same techniques, but of course the story dictates a different style of shooting and different tempo of how you're using the cameras, but. Iron Man 2, we had to shoot a lot of the plates, the background elements, and we had to go to Monaco during the Formula One, the Grand Prix we were actually there for several weeks, and that was a treat. And I've always been a race fan, a fan of that particular form of racing. Not much else, but the F1 cars are incredible, and we were able to get up close and see everything, and which it really translated to what we could do back, you know, here in California, where we did the B-side of all that action sequence we shot in Downey at Downey Studios, and they built the backside of the track, which is called the swimming pool area. And if anybody's seen the Grand Prix of Monaco, there's a swimming pool literally right next to the marina, and the cars race, you know, very close by. And so they essentially made a carbon copy of that, and there was green screen around, so all the elements that we did a couple of chase sequences there, not with Formula One cars, but with Jon Favreau's characters, Happy, the Tony Stark chauffeur, and so we had some chase sequences of a Rolls-Royce, 600 horsepower Rolls-Royce. It was nuts, but just going through and chasing it with a Russian arm, and we had a lot of other platforms that we were just doing a lot of different things. But the background, the plates for Monaco were used for that sequence. So we were there for several weeks in the south of France, and it was very memorable.
What's not to like about that?
Yeah, exactly. So, but they all have something that is very enjoyable. I mean, and then there's, we were also getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning, because we had to get first light, and those are working streets. Only time they close the whole, circuit off is for the race and for when they qualify. So we were able to get access to that circuit for a few hours, and the earlier we could start rolling, the better. And just as a courtesy to the people in Monte Carlo and all, but it really when we got back to LA, we knew a little more about how these things should look, and it was a great thing to be there.
Now, talk about your relationship with the director of photography, because I think you mentioned before, correct me if I'm wrong, that is actually also common times the director of the second unit.
Sometimes. In the case with Jonathan Taylor, Jonathan's incredibly talented guy. He knows visual effects. He's been around, I think, I don't know how many James, how many Bond movies, but he started, you know, a long time ago as a clapper loader, and I think he's done.
I know a lot of people think that because on like smaller budgeted films, the DP will also be the person operating the camera,
right,
that they don't necessarily get the full distinction between the two positions on a bigger budgeted film.
Right. In the case with you know, someone like Jonathan, he was the director and the director of photography, but he also relies on his crew, his gaffer, his key grip, Dan Riffle, the gaffer, Richard Mall, the key grip. They have incredible crews, just amazing people. And then Jonathan's camera crew, which I'm part of, we've done like 12 or 13 movies together. And so it's a bit of a family, and we kind of have a shorthand on what the mission is. And so Jonathan really doesn't have to go through a whole lot of explanations, but he loves setting crash cameras, and he loves the process of being really engaged with camera placement. And so we really discussed the shot, what is the best tool to capture, especially if it's an action sequence. There's so many different ways to shoot a particular shot, and Jonathan's really intuitive, but he also allows for you know, for the operators and the assistants, for that matter, to go in and have fun and find shots that otherwise maybe are beyond what the previs, and of course the audience probably knows what the you know, a lot of movies, especially effects action movies, there's a pre-visualization that it's created that really is the blueprint for how sequences should be shot. But it's like a storyboard, just a moving storyboard.
And how involved in that process are you?
Well, that's created months early, and it's signed off by a lot of different people. And of course, you know, it's a great guide, but there's that, and then there's reality. Sometimes physics will just dictate that the car can't do that, but or the camera can't move that quickly around the car. But you figure out, as best you can, a way to accomplish that, and then hopefully there is a happy accidental thing that happens, like, wow, that makes the shot even better. And then so you shoot the previs, but then you shoot something that is this evolution of, like, everybody's looking at, like, well, you know. And usually with in the case with a director for a second unit, when there's a DP and a director, there's a director's wishes that if he's a visual effects person or if he or she is a stunt person, they bring a lot to the party, and they have real specific ideas on how to make that shot work for them, and which ultimately has to go back into the workflow of what the main unit is doing. And so there's a lot of collaboration going on. Everything is handmade. You know.
Well, it sounds like you brought the Canon 5D into the equation, right? They wanted that scene to be shot and go down a certain way,
right?
But you were the one who kind of made that particular, you know, part of it.
Right. Yeah. Know. I mean, it was just out of the necessity of, you know, I was telling a friend of mine, Dennis Stewart, who's the executive producer, one of them on Iron Man 2, and Dennis is. I mean, he's really such a great guy, and he thought I'd lost my mind. I think he told me that. He says, this Canon thing, I have no idea what, you know. I said, well, look, I mean, on the first Iron Man, we destroyed a camera, and it happens all the time on Die Hard 4, same thing, as, you know, and it's a shame. You hate to see these lovely precision pieces of equipment get destroyed, and you don't want to see that happen to a Canon 5D. Either, but just the form factor of the 5D made a lot of sense. And what I felt was, this is a great way to get those 30 frames or 40 frames or even 20 frames of this shot in a way that we could do it without endangering a film camera and still potentially protect the Canon, and which ultimately happened. We did some damage, but in the total of four and a half months of filming, $2,500 worth of damage, as opposed to $20,000 or $60,000 worth of damage, which is often the case.
And having to reshoot some, and having to reshoot.
And having, well, it, or you lose the shot. Right. Usually you have, like in the case with the Monaco sequence, you have so many cameras covering it. So if you lose, if a camera is lost, it's a shame. Right. And it's just wasteful. And there's always a way, there's an elegant way to put a camera in a place that where if you just keep looking at how the stunt or how the effect is going, you can say, you know, if we sidestep another 2 feet and do this and build a little bit of a buffer, we could potentially save this camera. And that's what it's all about, is to, and that comes from, you know, just being around it for a long time. And
what is the difference between the relationship of director of photography, camera operator, and director in the United States of America and in England?
Well, that's a good question.
It's a good question that you inspired me to ask before we came on.
Well, in here in the States, it's a great system that the director of photography is working primarily with the director. He also has his technical crew, the gaffer, the key grip, and setting lights and flags and all the different lighting control going on in that scene. He's also working with the production designer. So the director of photography is all about, you know, combining the forces of the technical crew, and the operator is certainly there trying to execute the shot more from the director of photography's needs and his framework. And of course, it works. There's some great movies that have been shot here, and it's a really wonderful system. In England, it's a little different in that the director of photography is more about the lighting, and the operating of the shot is a combination of the director and the operator or operators plotting out the shot, going through the blocking with the actors, and really working with the idea of using the camera as this wonderful tool to help tell the director's story. And of course, the director of photography is right there along. It's not like he's just lighting and not paying attention to what's going on between the director and the operator, but there's more of a one-on-one relationship with the director in the English style, with the operator and the director, where as American style, it's the director, the DP, the operators. It's more of a combined collaborative effort.
Dick Nam would like to ask, is there anything you would like to see cameras do, but the technology is yet to be available? Avatar just, you know, took things up a notch.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that I saw pictures of, actually, Richard Mall, who was the key grip on the second unit for Iron Man 2, he went to go do Avatar, and Richard, you know, he was telling me about the size of the cameras and all, and it's, you know, of course, you want the camera to be small, light, rugged, everything that a camera should be, and you know, and it's an evolution. It's a bit of a tricky game right now. You spend $2,600 on a 5D. The next iteration of that could be raw data at 24 frames, incredible low light sensitivity like the 1D Mark IV for $3,000. So you're constantly upgrading, but you know, that's what's going to happen. And then who knows, Canon or Nikon or some, you know, yet to be created company may come out with a stereoscopic full frame sensor camera that the 3D rig is 15 pounds. You can put it on a helicopter. You can put it on a Russian or an Ottoman arm or a pursuit arm. You can put it anywhere, underwater housing. That's what's, it hasn't been created yet, because all the efforts right now is that you have to make a system and amortize it. So you have to be careful, and the industry is having to be careful on self-cannibalization. So RED has to pay for its first generation. If it releases second generation too soon, they run the risk of a lot of people getting angry, and so it's a real tricky place to be. Film right now supplies a real, supplies something that it's, like I said, it's a mature system, and you still, I hope it stays around for a long time. the digital technology to come, I hope the true measure will be that they have made a imager that is somehow more organic, and what it's shooting for is to be better than film. Not as good, not almost as good, but better than film. So it's exactly the way we see the universe. And film is chemistry, we're chemistry, everything we look at is chemistry. A pixel is a really beautiful design, but it's not chemistry. And so once, and I have no idea what's to come, but I'm excited that it's going to be hopefully going toward that end.
Well, just in talking to you, two things come to mind. Joe Cicio would like things that are lighter and more indestructible.
Yeah, well, you know, it's like, I mean, there's, I did a project recently in New York, and we shot Super 16. It was all handheld and loved it. It was a project that Darren Aronofsky was directing, and he loves film, he loves the process, but he loves Super 16 because the camera is light and you know, you could do a lot with it. Yeah, light is good. Light is, you know, we want the camera to be an extension of the director's eyes, the director of photography's eyes, the operator's eyes. And the heavier the rig is, the bigger the rig. It's a tough thing. You can still make it work. There's some incredible projects that are shot with massive, you know,
Joe cameras. Doesn't like those 100-pound 3D cameras.
but it's a tough way to get there, and I hope, you know, that hopefully soon there will be rigs that will, you know, it's tough to make the perfect camera because, you know, to make something to do 2D that also does 3D that weighs 25 pounds, I mean, that's asking for a lot. But
well, I see an interesting instant message that I'm also going to combine with a question I have for you. Let's see if I can blend this just right. All the J-Man would like to ask, could you describe some elements that made the action scenes so realistic for Iron Man, for Iron Man 2. Can you describe the elements that made the action scenes so realistic for Iron Man 2? And what I want to add to that is I read an interesting interview with Jon Favreau where he was talking about combining the practical and non-practical elements, the fun and challenges of shooting in a virtual world. And if you can just kind of let that ruminate with the question and let me hear what you think.
Repeat the question one more time.
Sure. Could you describe some of the elements that made the action scene so realistic for Iron Man 2? And I know you were combining from that interview practical and non-practical elements. And for the audience, practical and non-practical meaning computer or effects versus or miniatures even would be a non-practical, right?
Yeah. It's there was a departure on Iron Man 1. The suits were practical suits. So you either had, you know, Robert Downey wearing the Mark I or the Mark II suit, you know, the lid would come up, and which was the case on Iron Man 2 as well. But then for fight sequences, the technology has improved so much that you can have the stunt doubles or even Robert or Don Cheadle to wear the suits that have tracking markers, and they can skin that and put the CG suits in the seat. It looks so realistic. It's amazing. The thing that brings it all back together is to make sure that the background, so whether you're in, there's a Japanese garden sequence where you know, Rhodey and Tony Stark are in the this biosphere that's a Japanese garden. Drones are there about to attack them and all. And I don't think that was illegal for me to tell hours before the movie's released. But basically, the Mike Riva, who is the production designer, he and his team did such an incredible job with making it look organic, and it was organic and real. Even cherry blossom trees that were the cherry trees were in full bloom. There was a little waterfall. It was amazing to do the action sequences and the fight sequences in that background, in that environment. Really, I think that's maybe what John was talking about, is to take the non-virtual, the CG elements, and put them with a with this real organic backdrop, and that keeps
looking real.
It keeps it looking real, keeps the audience engaged, And that's what it's really about. You know, it's a real tedious process, but when it's done in a way and you figure out an elegant way to make all those elements come together. Yannick serves, and he was the effects supervisor. Yannick, I worked a little bit on I Am Legend with. He and his team are incredible, and they did such an incredible job with making, you know, John's vision and Marvel and what the whole Iron Man story come alive because of those elements have to be done really well, and that's I think that was accomplished. You know, it's, I'm sure the audience is going to dig it when they see it.
Well, I know I'm looking forward to seeing it. Yeah. We're going to wrap up with a couple of quick questions. I wanted to ask you if you had to describe the position of camera operator, would you say it's all technical, it's all creative, it's 50-50, it's 75 technical, 25 artistic, creative? How would you break that down?
It depends on what day. I mean, certain jobs, it's really about telling the story with composition and using, you know, just the camera as this incredible tool that it is. And it's all about, you know, the script and the setting, the actors, the director working with you know, the actors and really making that come alive and using the camera, whether it's a film camera or a digital camera or whatever is coming down the you know, the pipe. It's still, that's a wonderful place to be as a camera operator, that you're really helping that vision come alive, and you're maybe introducing your own organic thing to it. But then, you know, on certain days, you're there dealing with a lot of different technical elements. So and on those days, you have to just, you know, switch gears and you go into the technical mode and knowing, like, what we can get by with. Okay, well, yeah, we've got wire removal here, and we've got a certain amount of cleanup work to do over here. We're shooting with VistaVision. We know we can get by with a lot there. And so it's just knowing the tools and knowing the technique and knowing how all that collaboration works with the effects guys, visual effects people, and every department is kind of working in unison. And so the operator can be a person that can really help that process if, you know, if they really know how to engage.
If the director runs a ship, that kind of encourages that.
Exactly.
Now the question we'd like to get everyone out of here on is, it's a really tough one, do you have a favorite set speak term?
there's so many. I mean, there was martini, of course, is wrap. This is the shot right before we wrap. I didn't get a chance to think too much about that one.
That's okay. We're live. Take your time.
I'm drawing a blank. My favorite set speak term.
Martini shot is a probably.
Martini is usually a good one. That's after hopefully no more than 12 hours. Right. You're ready. You've gotten already done your martini, and I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. You know what? You're thinking about that reminded me of a very important question to me. So I'm glad. I would like you to look at that camera, and say to be a great camera operator, you have to, and say that sentence.
To be a great camera operator, you have to know the material that you're working on, and hopefully read the script at least once, if not twice, and three times, and really know how to work well with your surrounding crew, the grip department, lighting, of course, the director of photography, the director, and you know, actors, and I think it's just having a sensibility to help be one of the people to tell the story properly. And there's so many things that go into it, but I think that's just really knowing the material and knowing how to be part of the collaborative effort.
It's been a pleasure having you on. Congratulations on Iron Man 2. It's going to be a big success starting in a couple hours now. I'm sure we're even closer to it.
I hope so.
And I look forward to more great work from you.
All right. Great, Jeff. Good meeting you.
You too. That's going to do it for this edition of Filmnut. Thanks once again to Joseph Cicio. Thanks for tuning in.